welcome to our ongoing series, Financing the Future. In the last four episodes, we have looked at various aspects of banking in terms of mergers. How do you garner the advantages that, you know, the three or four mergers that have happened in India have managed. In the fifth episode, we are looking at perhaps the most important topic for banking then and banking now, risk. How to manage risk. Risk is a part and parcel of banking. The moment a loan is sanctioned, risk is born, and it continues through the life of the loan and hence through the life of the bank. Today, I have with me two people who have managed risk for a long time for their respective banks because they have worked in multiple banks and have evolved security systems for their respective organizations. I have with me Mrutyunjay Mahapatra, now Managing Director and CEO of Syndicate Bank, but a person who set the technology backbone for State Bank of India a few years back. I also have with me Mr. B. Madhivanan, who is the COO of IDFC First Bank and had at that time, in his previous avatar, set the backbone for the then second largest bank in the country, ICICI Bank. So I guess the best stalwarts in the industry. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining me. Well, let me start with you, Mr. Mahapatra. First, let us look at the traditional problem of risk. Risk for a bank has always come from credit and market. Is there anything new to learn in that or are they all old lessons?
No, always, you know, bankers have to continuously rediscover what are the new elements of risk that are coming within these headline items. You know, bankers for convenience have put risks into some buckets like credit risk, like market risk, like operational risk or capital risk or reputation risk, so on and so forth. We keep on putting them in buckets. But as the society evolves, and as the complexities of financing, complexities of geographical spread and knowledge evolves, we keep on rediscovering the elements of risk. And one of those, of course, is technology risk in credit, or for that matter, people risk in credit.
Okay.
So these are new risks which are coming up.
Is technology helping control credit risk?
Oh, big time, big time. I mean, if there is any one big enabler that has dramatically changed the profile of a risk manager within a bank, I think it's the, not just, I mean, look at it from a good old days. You would be looking through reams and reams of paper, collate this data. So process was a bit more cumbersome and you were always worried about, do I have every possible data to discover the ability of the person, the intent of the person, or the stability of the person or the organization? In today's world, and I'll sort of caveat it with a bit of a thing that retail has progressed much faster than the corporate world. But today, the unique blend of tech and data and some of the social infrastructure that has been created within our country over the last decade specifically has enabled these risk managers to play with multiple combinations, build scenarios, build models. So this classic underwriting of credit or looking at the macro aspects and taking a call has actually moved into this new domain of using both. You have this 30,000 feet view, which continues on the good old principles that Mr. Mahapatra spoke about. And at the micro level, ability to look at deviations, ability to look at the trends, and accordingly take a call. So I think tech is playing a very big role, both in terms of standalone technology, as well as some of the enabling utility companies that are springing up to facilitate this model.
Okay, would you agree, Mr. Mahapatra? Does technology bring with it other operational risks?
Today, critical components of credit delivery, if you look from end to end, we look, credit delivery starts with an origination, then there is an underwriting, then there is a loan life management, then there is a collection if it goes to a stress
yes.
cycle. If this is a typical cycle of loan system in a bank, then each of these stages have now got critically dependent on technology.
Okay.
Today, probably a loan origination cannot be completed without a customer relationship management system or a sales call system. Similarly, underwriting cannot be completed without computing the various ratios. So, because of the exponentially increasing critical dependence on technology, we will have to look at technology as integral to each elements of bank's risk. So I believe that, you know, as you rightly told, whether risk management should is becoming increasingly a heterogeneous, complex, and intertwined play? Answer is yes.
Let me just dwell a little more on market risk because we didn't get into it at all. What role is technology playing, and what would your advice be to bankers on whether you can use technology? Because I mean, this is for Indian banks a very big issue, especially today when, you know, all of you are perhaps, or at least some of you are, big into SLR more than needed. And that also poses a market risk. SLR, the, you know, supposedly zero risk, is also going to pose a market risk.
Lata, there is a famous book called Wisdom of the Many.
Okay.
You know, it says, and market risk is nothing but, you know, ignoring the wisdom of many. Okay. The dealers and risk managers, they think that they are omniscient, and they keep on, you know, bringing their own traditional classical ways, ignoring telltale signs which are available. Okay. Wisdom of the many, which is market. So how do we capture? And as you told again, the market risk today, the wisdom of many is manifesting itself in many ways. And the technology called big data is capturing it. The social media sentiment analysis alone could be a big market risk manager. Because people are talking about, you know, somebody, some promoter doing some shenanigans, somebody is diverting money. It is all being spoken in social media much ahead of it gets reflected in the share price. So market risk today will not be based on a close knit or the cartel or a club of big dealers passing on information, or you are seeing market rumors getting reflected in your Bloomberg or a Reuters screen.
This is an eye-opener. Is it being done?
It is. Today, you know, the predictions, share price predictions for long term, for medium term, are being done. And today in US, at least to my knowledge, whatever I read, a large number of predictive analytics is based on factoring in social media and big data analytics. So market risk management is now traversing new frontiers.
All right. Madhivanan, your thoughts?
I look at it in two ways. One, let's go to the traditional technology. When you're running some of the systems which are facilitating the market risk and the ecosystem players, whether it be the stock markets, whether it be the treasury systems, etc., very mature in terms of in there. Usually there is this new world of agile, which we try to approach for surround systems. But when it comes to core banking systems, which are exploring the market risk concept, on an operational level, the risks are completely coming down dramatically because it's very rigorous. It's very, whether it be social media or whether it be specialists like Bloomberg, etc., who are able to feed it in, the speed at which or the rate at which you are able to get data and how scenarios can change even within a day in the world of a dealer is becoming big. This entire story, and there is also this other new world, and this I'll move away from the treasury part into some of the other market world, is if you had to look at a corporate evaluation. Earlier, you would always depend on classical people called the financial investigators who will go and do the... Today, if you want to do something similar to that, there are systems, there are fintechs who have the ability to crawl into various systems, bring in completely disparate data which you would not be aware about. And those are finding places into the way you evaluate a corporate or the way you evaluate a scenario, the way you evaluate a market position, and accordingly take positions. So it's happening. It should happen at a much faster pace, but the trend is very much there.
Well, we have to take a break, but we are coming back and asking you questions, more questions about data now that we have a CRILIC database, we have a CIBIL database. How is that working into controlling risk? As well, how is technology bringing in risk, like say phishing or cybercrime? All those questions to our experts in a minute after this break. Welcome back to this special edition of Financing the Future, our ongoing episode with Bank of Baroda. We have been speaking to top line bankers on various aspects of banking and the financial sector. We've been dealing with risk and technology in this edition, and I have with me the best minds, Mrutyunjay Mahapatra of Syndicate Bank and Madhivanan of IDFC First Bank. Well, let me come to control of credit risk through data. Like I said before the break, you now have the CRIC, which is a database of early warning stress, perhaps, if I understood it right. And you have CIBIL for MSMEs and even for retail. Is that controlling risk better in both these areas?
Undoubtedly so. Undoubtedly so, because CRIC has a small difference with a bureau, a credit bureau like CIBIL. CIBIL deploys algorithms to find out, what exactly is the credit profile, and based on a credit profile, what is the credit score, which helps banks to determine who to give credit, one. Second, to price their credit, because pricing the credit and is as much as important as, providing it. Unlike that, CRILC is for corporate borrowers, where, all incidents, it is like a log of, likely credit default events. That it is for the banks to consume that service. Banks have been mandated by the regulators to contribute and report to this database. And then what has happened is that, for example, in my bank and in most of the major banks, we are developing something called EWS. Various vendors are supporting, various technology are supporting, but the common aim is that could we predict or could we red flag an account ahead of a real default happening? And CRILC is happening there. So it is a great initiative. Lot of ground needs to be covered. But to your question, whether CRILC and CIBIL, today, we can always bank that somebody who is not a fly-by-night operator who wants to operate for some time, the culture is coming back in the community where people want to protect their credit score. They don't want to have a default, okay, which is very, very good.
Mr. Madhivanan, have you all gone beyond the traditionally available sources to get to new ways of collecting data? Maybe social media or AI, if something is happening there, artificial intelligence.
AI is a bit of a stretched word, so I would say that we should go in phases. So what started off with the bureau, which is typically a credit score, is a variable which is driven by the logic of the respective bureaus, and which they have their own algorithms, and that's why the multiple bureaus. So banks and within IDFC First Bank, the first initiative is usually take data from multiple bureaus, because each one of them has their own flavor. The next level of advance in decision science, as you're calling, is usually that you don't go for the score, you go for the variables that are getting collated at an aggregate level.
Okay.
So it's no more the fact that I have a score of 750 or an 800 or a 600. What are the variables that happen? And how is the time duration? How did you behave in the last 3 months? Is your direction upward or is your direction downward?
The delta. Right.
So that becomes a second bit. Now, I still won't call it AI. These are very discrete attributes which are picking up and playing around with it. Then you go to the next level, wherein you say, okay, these are people I know about. I know very well about Lata. I want to find people like Lata who still have not yet built a score. So that's where stuff comes in modeling. What has happened while we have not yet reached the world of Nirvana of AI, where everything happens, what is happening is this concept of machine learning. So you're able to pick up this huge, and we are talking about 3-4 million customers being issued in a monthly basis, a big chunk from a bureau, a big from not there. You're doing machine learning is doing what a human being or a modeler would have learned at a much faster pace, is able to retrofit it quickly, and you're scaling it up. But still there is a human decision involved, whether you're making the model or whether you're implementing the model.
Okay.
A typical metric that you would use is, to what extent can I do a straight through process without a human being involved, because I have written down all the validations, rules, and the model plays around. The day the model starts learning itself, that's AI.
Yes.
But I think there are always regulatory implications. We should understand it where we should go forward. But to answer your question, given the fact that somebody like an IDFC First Bank looks at inclusive from an asset perspective, you have no option but to go to a lot of people who have a lower footprint and therefore start using many more alternative sources of data so that you can make the model better and better. It's an ongoing exercise.
It's an ongoing exercise, and I guess it's going to get scaled up.
Exactly.
In your case, it was need.
Okay. That's what tech does.
But it does help you control risk lending to a new category of borrowers.
I think that's the second point which Mahapatra pointed out about how tech and risk is there at every point of the origination. So the rule is typically when you get them in with your eyes wide open. What is the odds of failure? But that doesn't stop there. Then that's when the monitoring, whether it be a corporate, MSME, the ability to monitor its transactions, the monitors, and that's where I think a big play is yet to happen, wherein instead of having localized data in both our earlier organizations, there is enough data because both were large. But if you look at the ecosystem, and that's where I think Krilsi is bringing in static data, events that could happen and that have happened. Imagine a mechanism where transaction flows are identified. The way we talk to each other in WhatsApp, imagine financial transactions are available at a public utility level and people could ping in there. That's where the corporate world will get into what retail is experiencing.
They're hoping to use GST data in that sense.
One such input.
Mr. Mahapatra, let me come to the more immediate problem. As a consumer, phishing is a huge issue. I mean, now this is problems, risk problems created by technology. How is that getting managed and how will that progress?
No, one is that, see, there cannot be ever enough technology to prevent phishing. Because many times phishing happens because the consumer himself or herself
gives herself away.
Exactly. So, I think the two sides of the coin, which we call, you know, managing cyber security at the grassroots level, is consumer awareness combined with technology.
That is true.
So phishing, I believe, I think it must, it should, technology should be there to find out what Madhi told just now, is to technology enough to find out patterns. Let us say I have always done a 500 rupees transaction and have never exceeded 500 rupees in my last 50. If somebody has indulged in phishing and doing a 10,000 rupees transaction,
the system should
have. This technology should catch it.
What are the risks that you as a banker would watch out for because of cyber?
Again, two frames. What we spoke about the phishing was more the behavioral side, wherein we have limited control of how to prevent it other than education. And this is, scenario has not changed. I joined banking in around 1999. And that time we used to run ads which showed a phishing rod with the fish and say, do not share, because my previous bank was one of the earlier drivers of digital. And since then, even today, once we have a lot more millennials coming in, the maturity has behaved it, the scenario has not changed dramatically. Because the fraudsters are becoming smarter, they are using much more contextual stuff. So what happens is, in such cases, and I'm calling this as a genuine risk because this is what hits you immediately. So there are services and processes which are coming in which have the ability to pick up these IPs and numbers and quickly lift them. So you might not be able to make it zero, but there are enough mechanisms that are trying to minimize the damage. So it's almost like a risk.
Yes.
How do I manage risks which are not, we call it the social technology risk, not necessarily cyber. Ability to use social engineering to defraud people by using what is popular and thereby riding on it. On the second hand, if you look at some of the most thriving industry, I mean, as a tech head or a responsible, no, rarely does any organization will question you, or CFO will rarely question you if there is a investment which is happening on security. And it's genuinely the need of the hour, because it's a race between the good boys and the bad boys. There are equally brilliant people sitting on the other side or trying to make
on
up
the hacking side. Yes.
Yeah. So whether it's hacking, whether it's, you know, looking at the new malware, and the more pervasive technology becomes and more digital you become, in a way, you're becoming porous. So your ability to ensure that the ports are open, where does a border begin? I mean, both of us will be very familiar with this concept of demilitarized zone. First, we thought that is where my final moats are.
Yes.
But now that's also equally, because if you want to look at API, open banking, you will have to step out. You can't sit inside and hope.
Go from core to the cloud.
Exactly.
You are giving away some data.
And it's not that I can wait, because the other guys are who are non-banking, who are fintechs, are coming and hitting us. So I have no choice but to play this game. So ability to build multi-level layer of security, constantly working, and not just limited physical barrier, but a dynamic way of analyzing data is what will drive us, and that's the name of the game.
Let me just give you one minute more, Mr. Mahapatra. You know, before we started the conversation, you said that even security should be a public utility, cyber security. A word on that.
As I told you, technology is becoming very pervasive. And in typical banking, how do we do a credit risk assessment? We look at the so-called four C's: character, capacity, capital, and collateral as the last one.
Okay.
So these are the four C's which we were taught when we were in the manual world. So, and each of these, character assessment, capacity assessment, capital assessment and collateral assessment. Everything depends on technology. Even for collateral, whether his property is registered with the registry or not, you need to run a search.
Yes.
So with this, you know, I believe that, you know, community data, exposing, for example, the other day I was talking to a senior Maharashtra state government official. A birth certificate is used for giving admission to your child. It is required for giving, you know, property information. So why it cannot be popular? It cannot be at one place. And why that cannot be a community platform which will expose APIs? Now, what we are seeing, e-Jeevan Praman or the so-called Umang software, is multiple services coming on the same platform. Yes. And that is what we spoke about Krilk or whatever, what we spoke about Sybil, are such community security infrastructures which have to be used by people who either do not understand the technology or do not have the capability to invest in technology. I think that is the way forward.
Okay, so while data also is a public good, cyber security also should be built. Correct. As a public good. That's one big learning from our experts. But the other thing, in terms of educating the consumer so that the consumer also is not a victim of these kinds of risks. Thank you very much, Mr. Mahapatra and Madhivanan.
Thank you, Lata. Thank you.